Tell us again how you met Jack and Michael.
I was working at the Loring Nicollet Center in street ministry, and that we had a drop-in center, home drop-in center, and it was part of a coalition of youth serving agencies. Yes, youth serve, you know, the answering service, yes, and the Gay House was part of that coalition, and so I met Jack and Mike through that, a friend of mine, another Methodist minister who also had been in street ministry and worked with the Gay House, Jim Clayton, was going to marry Jack and Mike, and he had worked with him. But then two or three days beforehand, he said, "Oh, my papers aren't in order. I can't do it." Well, you know, you just go down to the city hall and you know, getting your papers in order is, you know, and so they came to me and asked me if I'd do it, and I said, "Sure, why not?" I had no idea what a big deal it was. But I was in favor of gay marriage, and so I did it.
And how old were they at the time, do you know?
No, I don't.
How old were you, do you remember?
Well, it was in 71, which is, what, 30, 40, yeah. I'm 70 now, I was in my 30s, in my mid-30s.
Did you think about it at all? I mean, nowadays people talk about gay marriage a lot.
Yeah.
Back then, I imagine it wasn't the same.
Oh, I thought about it. I thought about it quite a bit. When I was in high school, I had a good friend who was in the choir with me, church choir, and he was gay and committed suicide because he'd been harassed, and that, you know, really upset me. And so, you know, I was. And then when I was in seminary, I had my best friend came out to me, he was gay. And so I'd had a lot of experience and done a lot of thinking about it. Being a Freudian in my training, I was oriented to believe that homosexuality was a mental illness, but I was quickly disabused of that idea and realized that, you know, it's just an orientation, just the same as heterosexuality is, and why not? You know, we should be judged by who we don't love rather than who we love. And if the church is in support of faithful relationships, they should support gay marriage. I mean, why should the church have an investment in people not having committed relationships, committed long-term relationships? If anything is going to be stabilizing for the community, it's to have long-term committed relationships. And so I didn't see any reason why I shouldn't marry them. And I, to this day, don't understand how it can be a threat to heterosexual marriage.
Did you get any backlash?
Oh, yes. Yes, I did. Jack and Mike had a license. They had a legal license. And there wasn't anything in the church discipline, which is the Church Methodist Book of Rules, that said you couldn't marry two gay men, or two lesbian women for that matter. And so there wasn't any action, you know, they couldn't charge me with anything. And the letters, the bishop told me that the letters that he got telling him that they should defrock me were about the same number as those that had written in support. And so, you know, and I got a lot of hate mail and a lot of strong mail support. I got a letter from Boston addressed to Gay Hippie Minister, Minneapolis. That's all it said, Gay Hippie Minister, Minneapolis, and it came to me. and that was a letter of condemnation. And I had a lot of speaking engagements, and there were a number of two very conservative ministers that kind of hounded me. Whenever I would speak, they would show up and harass me. And so, and one of them, a Southern Baptist minister, actually, in one of our interviews in my office, tried to seduce me.
How ironic.
Yes, yes, it was very ironic, yeah.
Was some of that backlash hurtful?
No, it wasn't, no. I mean, I didn't have any threats, and nobody threaten my family or anything. No, there was no threats of physical violence.
Let's talk about that license, because it's sort of interesting the way that they went about it.
Yeah.
The name, the adoption and the name change. What did you think when they came to you with that? You knew in full disclosure.
Yes, right.
What did you think about it?
Well, you know, it, whatever works. I thought, yeah, I didn't see anything wrong with it.
Did you talk to them about it?
Yeah. They talked to me about it, and I thought, well, Jack's a lawyer, and so. But you know, I don't think they would have even had to do that. I mean, if they would have been just Jackie Baker and Michael McConnell, I mean that, and I'm sure that they, that the clerk of court in Mankato wouldn't have questioned that either.
Talk to me about that day and what you remember about the ceremony, what it was like.
Mm-hmm.
I just bring us there.
Yeah, well, it was in a home. It was in a Victorian home in South Minneapolis near Lake, near Lake and Park, I think. One of those big old Victorian mansions. And there were a lot of people there. They recorded it. It was a warm day. And it was a traditional marriage. You know, it was a traditional marriage ceremony. And then at the end of the service, I can remember distinctly when I pronounced them husband and husband, and they kissed. I just had this tremendous sense of, wow, this is really different. It was shocking to me, you know, because it was different. And really challenged me to come to terms with my own innate homophobia, and which I did. But it was a very happy time, we actually did the service twice. We did it, in, you know, just straight, and then we did it again and filmed it. So it was on film.
What do you think about everything that's happened in the year since, with, you know, the amendment and then this week?
I'm very, very happy that this has happened. And I could see it coming. In the Methodist Church, we have an annual conference every year. And gay issues, you know, ordaining gay ministers and gay marriage, all those issues would come up every year at the conference. And at first they were soundly defeated. But then the numbers got closer and closer and closer until finally they would pass. Of course, they wouldn't pass the general conference, but at Minnesota, they passed. And so I can see, you know, when the Methodist Church is relatively representative of the culture of Minnesota, and so I could see it, you know, things gradually changing.
And you mentioned Jack and Michael still together.
They're still together. They're happily married. It's one of my more successful marriages. I've never had any regrets about doing it, and feel very happy that I did.
What did you learn from this experience as a person and as a minister?
Well, you know, I learned about you know, the importance of love, the strength of love, and that love doesn't have a gender, and that. You know, we need to support committed relationships. And also I found that, you know, it was a pretty radical thing to do at the time. And there were a lot of people that said it was stupid to have done it, but I've never regretted it and have never really suffered any consequences, except just recently there was a church that told me that they didn't want me after they realized I'd married a gay couple. But I found the church to be very supportive of me and my ministry. And for a long time, I had dropped out of the ministry for a long time and worked as a general contractor and worked for the mentally ill. And then I came back. I came back into the ministry, and people received me with open arms. And so I found that, you know, the Methodist Church is really supports social justice issues. So,
opponents of gay marriage often rely on the Bible and church. And
yeah, like it's interesting. And the arguments that they use, and this was pointed out in the discussion before the Senate Monday, the arguments they use are exactly the same arguments that the anti-segregation people used back in the 60s to oppose civil rights for blacks. There are very few places in the Bible that makes any reference to homosexuality, and those passages in Leviticus refer to temple prostitution. The term homosexuality is a relatively recent one. There isn't really a term for homosexuality in the Bible, and they often cite Sodom and Gomorrah. Sodom and Gomorrah, the sin of Sodom was not homosexuality. It was inhospitality to the foreigner. And Jesus makes reference to that. Yeah, he cites that and as being a sin against a foreigner rather than anything having to do with homosexuality. Jesus never said anything about homosexuality. You know, he made some references to marriage, but it wasn't exclusive. And Paul makes a reference to that we're not even sure what the word means. But it's a very fleeting reference, and probably refers to the Greek practice of sexually exploiting young boys, rather than long-term committing gay relationships. So homosexuality is not a big issue in the Bible.
Did you think when you were standing there that day that it was potentially, most likely, the first gay marriage?
Yes. I knew it was, and they were very clear about that. It was the first gay marriage in modern history, with a legal license.
And what did you think?
I was excited. I thought, all right. I was excited about it, because it was obviously they loved each other, and they had every reason to be married, to live together in a committed relationship, and I was excited and honored to be a part of that.
And now, all these years later, seeing those crowds at the Capitol, did mm-hmm. you think that would happen?
No, I didn't. I didn't think it would pass. I was surprised. I was very encouraged by it. I was really amazed that John Ward in Brainerd and Joe Ordinovich in Crosby voted for it. That showed a lot of courage on their part. And they're now being targeted for recall. And so anybody that supports gay marriage needs to get behind them and support them now, because they need it. They need the support.
You mentioned, innate homophobia. I think a lot of people kind of experience that. What advice would you give to people who, want to accept this but maybe have some of those inner feelings?
Talk to a gay person. Talk to one of their relatives who's gay. And chances are very good that they have a relative who's gay or a neighbor. Talk to them.
What about someone who struggles with it because of religious beliefs? What would you tell them?
Nothing. There are people that have that belief. There's nothing that I'm going to say to them that's going to change their minds. They're pretty committed to that. I think a lot of the people that have opposed me the strongest, I believe, are one of two categories. Either they've been abused sexually when they were young, or they're a closeted gay person themselves. I mentioned that Southern Baptist minister that was so rabidly against me. And he propositioned me. He was obviously a closeted...